people in the name of our Lord and our Master. It is good to be here. I'm surprised I'm here. I got there a few weeks ago and I said, I'm here. I said, oh. I told the pastor, I said, I'm always willing to come. I wasn't sure if I was. I said, forgive me a change up and get somebody else. So I'm just delighted and honored that you invited me to come again. So this is my third year. So I'm just delighted. And so I tried to prepare some things for you. So I'm hoping you'll like my home cooking. I enjoy yours so much. So we're grateful. It's nice to meet you, Pastor Evans. I said,
my cup is saturated. Surely goodness and
covenant faithfulness shall pursue me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for the duration of days. It is that first verse. Let's just focus on it just a little bit as I give you a couple of references. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall never want. The first clause provides the preface for the profession in the second clause. Now, the preface is the point of fact upon which the profession is based. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall never want. Since the Lord is the believer's shepherd, his governor, his king, his ruler, his sovereign sustainer, since the Lord supplies every need of those who trust him according to his riches and glory, the believer can confidently claim that there's nothing that he needs that the Lord does not provide. Right. Grass is regularly provided for nourishment. Water consistently is found. Correctful safe passage for travel is always afforded. In the midst of and in spite of dangers, protection is a constant staple. On top of that, in face of harassers, annoyers, enemies, sustenance in abundance is succulently satisfied. Sustained, such that the believer is completely certain that his residence is always under the supervision of the Lord. Right. In essence, the believer asserts that his needs are non-existent. Right. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall never want. There's actually nothing that the believer must have that he does not already.
All right.
Hear another word. The Lord is my shepherd. I should not want.
Right.
The first clause provides the premise for the prohibition in the second clause. The premise is the basis, the ground, the supposition upon which the prohibition is level. He says, the Lord is my shepherd. Since I got everything in him, I should not want. Since the Lord is the believer's shepherd, his governor, his king, ruler, sovereign, sustainer, there's nothing else that the believer can imagine that the Lord does not already provide.
Right.
There's nothing beyond grass, water, safety, protection, security. There's nothing that is needed that the Lord does not supply. In such a situation as this, in light of circumstances as such, whatever else there could be that the Lord has not provided, as unimaginable as it is, the believer should not be.
All right.
In essence, the believer asserts that his desires are off limits. Since I got everything, I don't need nothing else.
All right.
Really, the believer doesn't want, because that is unfaithful, is ungodly, is disrespectful, since the Lord provides everything and is all in all.
Right.
Here's the two ripples. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall never want, and I should not want.
All right.
Oh, God. Notice now that the providence of the Lord, it negates me and it prohibits probing. With the Lord, mourning is inadequate, inappropriate, insufficient, while craving, desiring, looking for more is absurd and absolutely ridiculous. If you have everything, you don't need anything. If you're with him who's all sufficient, going to the grocery store makes no sense. In other words, trusting the Lord is an all-exclusive option.
Yes.
When you stay with the Lord, you don't need anything else.
Right.
You don't think there's a category as, I call it poor mouth Christians. They stand up and recite, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And they're always talking about what they don't have, what they can't do, where they can't go, what they can't achieve, or what they are missing. I'm not talking about the faithful, those who trust the Lord, who he is bringing through trials, tribulations, and troubles. I'm talking about those who make mockery of the Lord because of their lack of tenacity in trust.
All right.
The Lord satisfies them with so much good that they get fat with his blessings, but they claim they don't have enough of this to do that, or enough of that to do this, and their efforts for the Lord are always shortchanged if they are attempted at all. The Lord leads them to promising and prosperous possibilities, yet they won't pick up a pencil.
Right.
They won't open a Bible. They won't exercise a bona fide prayer, won't step out in faith, won't take God and his word since he's in charge, and try him in trust. In fact, they stay in their comfort zone and don't try anything
trouble, or they cry that they can't do this or they can't do that. These mockers don't even have the holy audacity to get up off of their assets and claim the blessings right outside their doors that the Lord has for them, but they can't from them. Let me talk to you. If the Lord is our shepherd, we must not be stingy with his blessings.
All right.
We ought to be overflowing in his goodness, voluntarily sharing his blessings, and open-handedly spreading his grace everywhere. For Paul says God is able. He's able to provide you with every blessing and abundance so that you will always have enough of everything and provide an abundance for every good work. If the Lord is our shepherd, we should be sowing in his vineyard right where we are rather than sitting on our do-nothing. For Paul says, the point is this, that he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must do as he's made up his mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver.
Yes,
if the Lord is our shepherd, no one should be begging us to show up, to sacrifice, to serve, to be obedient, to do what we say. Paul says, I appeal to you, brothers, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to the God. That is your spiritual worship. Let be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the will of God, what is good, what is acceptable, and what is perfect. If the Lord is our shepherd, and we are as blessed as we sing around, we should never be short in sacrifice or service to our God. Paul tells us, be not deceived, that God is not mocked. Whatever you sow, that you also reap. If you sow to your own flesh, you will from your flesh reap corruption. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will from the Spirit reap eternal life. Let us not grow weary in doing good. For in due season, he said, we will reap if we don't give up. If you will, just cast your bread upon the water, for you'll find it after many days. I've been young now, but now I'm old.
Yes, sir.
I have not seen the righteous forsaken, or the seed begging bread. He's ever given liberally, and even his children is among the blessed. I just want you to understand how blessed we are. How blessed we are. Our children grew up downtown and went cross town and now live uptown in our town. Because the Lord opened doors and made ways for us when we were between a rock and a hard place. Our children dodged bullets. They maneuvered around gangs. They sidestepped drug pushes. They overcame obstacles, seized the prizes that were before them, and came into the fullness of God's favor. Our children are renowned scholars, college standouts, professors and medical doctors, entrepreneurs of every endeavor and enterprise. Because the Lord is not stingy with his amazing grace and his tender mercies. Our children were born on eagle's wings, two or three doors that were slammed shut in the faces of maids and servants who rocked the cradles of the cultures that crippled them. Our children, really your children, I don't have a child or a chicken, did not have to deal with Jim Crow, shady segregation, or sorry, back of the bus salad, but to come to the head of the class, to stand at the front of the line, and have a right to decent service, to fair treatment, to legal representation, to proper pay, to good health insurance, to one vote, to unemployment compensation, even the audacity to hold an elected office, and lead these United States. Exiles from the dark continent, survivors of the Middle Passage, descendants of chattel slaves, have risen to the ranks of a representative democracy that didn't represent them, to walk in high places, to be the head and not the tail, to be the first and not the last. And you tell me the Lord is our shepherd, and we shall not want. Yet too many of us won't set down superficial intelligence, won't put away pseudo dignity, won't get rid of cultural cuteness, and give God a
right.
Father,